Shalom. We are still preparing Parasha Matot Masei, dual Torah portion. I think it's 41, 42, or 42, 43. We're getting close to the middle of the feast cycle. We're now in the fourth month. As we discovered, we are in the season of the receiving of the tablets. So I just want to quickly recap based on what I said yesterday and the day before regarding Shavuot. For those who are not familiar with where I came about these things, it will be good if you can go back to the parashas. I think it was Emor, which has to do with the mountain. I think it was 31:30, Torah portion 31:30. Go back and listen to that to get an idea of where all these things came from. So basically, in a nutshell, Shavuot is not a one-day festival. It's not in a specific time, but it is. But what I mean about that is that Shavuot consists of multiple events. We've got Israel arriving at the mountain. Prior to that, day 50, experience, which is part of the counting of the Omer, and that is preparing as the bride and a warning to the bride. Then we have day 61, cleansing at the mountain, that's part of Shavuot. Then 63, Yahweh speaking from the mountain, the 10 words, that's part of Shavuot. Then we go to day 103, which has to do with receiving the first set of tablets, which is also part of Shavuot. That's where we are currently at within our time frame, counting the Omer from our first fruits within this yearly cycle. And then there's an unknown time, which is not specified, that ends round about the end of the sixth month. That's a biblical month, leading into the seventh month with Yom Teruah. And that is the second set of tablets that will be received, the perfect tablets, which has to do with the end times. It has to do with the mountain again and King Mashiach teaching the Torah from the mountain. So that's Shavuot's themes. And Shavuot is a spread of events while you count the Omer. And as it says with the Feast of Trumpets, is the day that we don't know, day and hour we can't calculate. Why? Because it was not disclosed in the scripture how long Moses stayed in his tent until he went back up the mountain and then spent 40 days, which will take him up to day month 7. So that is the reason why we can't calculate that precisely. But since having the Feast of Trumpets as a date, a day specified in Torah, that will give us the pinpoint within the feast cycle of when that is prophetically, and I think that's when it happened physically in history, in the time of Moshe. That's just a quick recap on Shavuot. So reading this Torah portions, Matot Masei, there's an instruction regarding the sacrifices, which I touched on earlier, and now there's the instructions or the commandments for entering into the land. So it's not just like, oh, there's a river, jump over the river, walk through the river, or swim through the river, and then you're there, and you can just do what you want, pick a spot, you know, put your stake down, the ones who's there first can get it. No, it's an organized process for entering the land. There's specific commandments for entering the land that is added or additional to the Torah and the Ten Commandments. Now those commandments will only come into play before we enter into the land. It was in the day, historically, those commandments came into play, and now, prophetically, before we enter into the land, we need to adhere to the same commandments. So what are those commandments? The first one, as I mentioned, is about the sacrifices, specifically regarding the Moedim. So that basically highlights and confirms the fact that we are supposed to do the Moedim. The sacrifices can't be done because there's no temple, but or tabernacle, but we can celebrate the theme or the intent or what it's about, to learn about it in order to prepare ourselves. And those things that we can do, then we know what to do and how to prepare for that day that is coming, that's associated with the Jordan judgment and the great tribulation. Now the second instruction, set of instructions, is about entering into the land, crossing over. Now the commandment I'm going to look at are two things that we're going to discuss in this parasha, and the one is about the thorn in the side, is to get rid of the idols, about the things that the nations will bring in into that space, or in their context, in historic context, they were the inhabitants of the land in that day, and they sacrificed to their idols and they worshiped their idols. Now within the context where we are going to enter into, there are going to be people who are survivors that will come out of the first war. I call it the first war because there are two wars on either side of the seventh millennium. Number seven is the pinnacle of the ages, which is similar to the Sabbath, the pinnacle of the week. And the seventh millennium is preceding the eighth millennium, the start of the new cycle. And entering into there, you have a war prior to the seventh millennium, you have a war at the end of the seventh millennium. The first one is Armageddon, the other one is Gog and Magog. And we've looked at those in our previous Torah study. So those who don't know what I'm talking about, please go back. It's probably two or three Torah portions back, probably 39, 38. Just go through those and you'll get more insight into the seventh millennium and the eighth millennium and what will happen. Now the survivors from the seventh, or the great tribulation, the battle of Armageddon, they will enter into the land, but the land in that time frame is desolate. It's destroyed. Judgment. Babylon was removed and destroyed, and now they have to go through a restoration process and a building up process. That's where the thorn in the side and the mixed multitude of nations will have their habits, their gods, their ideas intermingled with Christians and Jews and atheists that will now need to inhabit the land and restore the land. And basically there will be two groups, as we read at the end of the seventh millennium. Some of them will be inside the city that they rebuilt, which is Jerusalem. The others will be on the outside, the far skirts, outskirts of the land, and they will come. And they will come and attack the people that inhabits Jerusalem. And then the fire will come down, which is Gog and Magog. So that is the scene and the setting of why there are commandments for entering the land. Those are applicable for the people who are not part of the bride, and they enter into the promised land, but in the wrong time frame, or not the wrong time frame, the time frame of the wine press. Now the bride has been gathered, and the bride is with Mashiach, and the bride will come down with the city after the cleansing of the earth, after Gog and Magog, and then she will inhabit the land as a ruler and as the kingdom of priests that will service and facilitate worship in the tents around the mountain with the nations. So that's the thorn in the side, why it's applicable. Now I'll probably touch on tomorrow on the idea of lots, casting lots. So there's another interesting storyline there that will unfold. I'll keep that one for tomorrow. So I hope you have a lovely day, and be blessed. Shalom.